The only other thing I would say before I tell you what we're going to do is that for someone who's been around this long and is in a room like this, I can tell you this is a bunch of returning radicals. We should do this more often. Okay, so we weren't quite at that point, but I think I will just say now that Judge Ross, we understand you have a birthday. So, I know that we have people who can command really loud voices. So, on three. One, two, three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ross. Happy birthday to you.
Shelly, do you want to, are you going to read that now? Great. And then I'll tell you where we're going after that. We actually are organized.
Well, the birthday cake, since Judge Doris Smith-Grippner could not be here for this occasion, but visited with Judge Ross earlier this week, and has contributed the cake to honor Judge Ross, I want to read a letter from Judge Doris Smith-Grippner. To my dear friend, Judge Eunice Ross, decades ago at law school, I could not be there today, but I'm so glad I had the opportunity to spend time with you this past Sunday, sharing memories that I've had. And I thank the Women in the Law Committee of the Allegheny County Bar Association for hosting this wonderful celebration. You've inspired so many women lawyers in Allegheny County to strive for greatness and to stand up for justice and fairness in our legal profession. Many are who we are today because you were their leader and guide. As a judge on Common Pleas and later as a senior judge on Common Pleas Court, you exhibited nothing but high standards in judicial temperament, integrity and honesty, and were an example of judicial greatness. Lawyers looked forward to appearing before you because we knew that no matter what the outcome, your decisions would be fair, well-reasoned, and honest. You were and always will be a genuine role model. I thank you for encouraging me to share with the class the estates and trust work that I handled for the law firm that employed me throughout law school. I thank you for inspiring me to persist, no matter how daunting some cases appear to be that I handled as a lawyer. And I thank you for gently nudging me toward the judiciary when that call came in 1984. Judge Ross, you've touched so many lives and have made a profound and lasting impact upon the legal profession in Allegheny County, and indeed throughout our state. This is your day, and may you enjoy it and many more to come. You deserve the honors. Happy birthday. Sometimes have people jumping out of cake. And since this is the Women's Law Division of Ross, we're doing it our way, and we brought together for this event to celebrate you and your birthday a man to jump out of the cake who has been very instrumental in your life and your travail, which we'll talk about in a little bit. And I'd like for that man in the cake to come forward, Mr. Peter Stewart. Please come on. Peter was the attorney who represented Judge Ross in her fight against the Supreme Court and Judge Savarella to enable her to go back to she loved the most.
chance I ever met. Just know that at a point in my life where I thought that there could not be justice in the court system, God brought us together in a divine appointment to try to improve a very difficult system. And as we work together, I want you to know that it was your wisdom, your courage, your intellect, your heart that made it possible for impossible things to happen. Under God's loving and guiding hand, you were his instrument to show many people that what is noble in our profession can exist even amidst a dark and fallen world. I will always be grateful for the example that you gave me.
I just want to thank, Jessica introduced everyone. I have to tell you, she is an amazing person. I told her I'm going to call her law firm. We definitely say she's qualified to be on the management track. And she's getting married in a week. And you have no idea what she did to pull this together. 2 weeks, somebody said.
2 days.
Till 2 days.
I
also wanted to acknowledge Bob Riffle, who has really helped put this whole thing together. Bob, where are you? I haven't met you yet, so. And also Judge Ross's companion, Vladimir. We know how important you are in her life, and we really appreciate everything you've both done to help make this possible. So what's going to happen now is that Shelley, Judge Friedman's going to introduce Judge Ross, and then we're going to have a short dialogue with Ellen and Judge Friedman and Judge Ross, and then I'll tell you what's going to happen after that.
Well, obviously, Judge Ross needs no introduction. I guess those of us, many of us, most of us here, know the law, or think we do, or hope we do. And I'm going to just turn the phrase a little bit and say, feminine, it's the low blow. The woman speaks for herself. What she has done, what she's accomplished, and who she has set an example for is more than words can express. But I have to tell you that I met Judge Ross first in 1972, when there were about 8 or 10 of us sitting in a small living room in the Ruskin apartment at the home of Gretchen Donaldson and her sister. And we talked about, Judge Ross had just been elected to the bench, and Judge Marion Finkelhor, and there were no women to set the example, no women to show us the way, no women around, except those we have of posterity, to set the example and to tell us that our job was to do what's just. And so through the years, every person you touched grew and learned, and many of us, as many as could make it, are here today to honor you. It's important that those of the new attorneys who are practicing, and such accomplished women, see what the road has been. And that was why the Women in the Law Division created this event, so that you could take the past and bring it forward and make it your own. That meeting in that little living room left an indelible print. And every time you met Judge Ross, along the way, she would write a little note to thank you, to tell you what the event meant. Now, I mentioned that little note because as I was gathering materials together for this event, I found all these little notes tied into my file. Can you imagine going through your files, looking for a flash drive, give you a memory? It's just a remarkable turn of events through the year. And we're going to talk about her history. I'm going to turn it over to Ellen and Judge Ross for their conversation. But I just wanted to tell you where we began and how small it was and how much we've grown. And when I look at the accomplishments of the women for whom you set the goal, the banner, their accomplishments are more than we could ever have imagined in those days. And we thank you for that. I also want to read to you a letter from Judge Mary Hannah Levitt, who's President Judge of Commonwealth Court. The Commonwealth Court was honored to have Judge Ross with us for her last stint as a judge. And she wrote this letter to Ms. Padgett. I and my colleagues on the Board of Judges of Commonwealth Court, Pennsylvania, congratulate the ACDA Women in the Law Division for choosing to honor Judge Eunice Ross. In 1998, before I became a judge, I appeared before Judge Ross while she was serving as a Commonwealth Court judge in our original jurisdiction act. All present at the hearing was struck by Judge Ross's keen intelligence and she was I learned a great deal from her that day. Please extend my personal congratulations to Judge Ross on her exemplary life and contribution to Pennsylvania jurisprudence. Sincerely yours, Mary Hannah Levitt.
So let's see if they can hear us. We're going to talk a little bit back and forth.
Thank you very much.
Can you hear that?
Yeah.
Ground, including the effect of the depression on your family and you as a child.
All right. Well, I grew up in a family where they didn't think that women shouldn't go places. My mother always thought I was going to go to my father.
You have to move the microphone.
Can you hear me?
No.
All right. I grew up in a family that didn't think that women shouldn't have high aims. My mother's relatives have been judges and lawyers. They rather expected that I would go that same path, and I did. So it wasn't terribly hard for me from the family standpoint. And I didn't realize at the time how poor other people were during the Depression, because we had a comfortable living. What we did was feed the poor, because there was no welfare in those days, no public assistance. And people would come to the house begging to be fed, and we would let them play the piano or do something, some job, so that they felt they were earning their meal and not getting a handout. I decided to go to law school after I'd been an assistant dean of women at Pitt, and I loved that job. I was in charge of the nationality groups. And it was wonderful. I met all the important visitors. I trained the hostesses that worked on the rooms. And I took important visitors around. The university didn't pay anything. You know, anybody who works for the university knows they don't like to pay you. And I became pregnant. My boss, who was dean of women, said that there really wasn't a place for me at the university anymore because I was going to be a mother. So at that point, I looked into my family background and decided, well, a lot of my relatives were lawyers and judges. Why can't I be a lawyer? I mean, there's no sex requirement for that. Actually, there weren't terribly many women lawyers at that time. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. When I started law school, there were 6 women in our class of 120. And half of our class flunked out. I don't know if it's still that way in law school or not, but we ended up with 60 and 4 women.
I was fortunate because I was first in my class, and the registrar at the law school, Mrs. Lindsay, I don't know if any of you knew her, but she was very successful in finding positions for me. And my first job was with the Public Health Law Research Project. And what we did was we drafted the environmental laws for Pennsylvania and the Clean Streams Act. All of the acts where you can't take the tops off the mountains. If you strip mine, you have to put the tops back on. If you ever go to West Virginia, you see where they don't have that legislation. They just take the tops of the mountains off and keep them. So that was a wonderful job. And after that, I went with two judges as their law clerk. One was the president judge of the court. His name was Judge McConker, and he was a wonderfully kind man. And he would see people who came in and try to help them if they didn't have a legal problem. But he also was indecisive. My friend Ann Hoop said he was a Pisces and you could see the fish swimming around. Couldn't make a decision. But Ann Hoop, who was a lawyer who worked for him, would get impatient and say, for heaven's sake, why don't you decide it this way? So then he would decide it and everybody would say, oh, isn't he wonderful? And he said, so I left that job to go with the, as a judicial assistant in the Orphans Court. And that was really a wonderful job. I worked for a man named Hugh Boyle, whose uncle was the Bishop of Pittsburgh. And Judge Boyle, I don't want to say this enjoyed poor health, but he wasn't very well and he didn't come in very often. So that left me with a lot of authority. And so what I did was help draft the probate code and the rules of court. I answered the questions for the decree clerks who made the decrees of distribution. I answered the questions to the public. So it gave me a great training to be a judge. And the strange thing was, when it came for me to be appointed, I was appointed by the governor to replace an Orphans Court judge. And Judge Boyle called me and said, well, he said, this is a man's court. We don't have women judges up here. But as it turned out, a few years later, when Mike O'Malley became the president judge, he replaced Judge Boyle with me. Senior judge then, so it really didn't, amount to much. He was already a senior judge. But after that, I served in the Orphans Court for quite a while, until one day I was at a judicial conference, and a wonderful judge from the East, whose name was Judge Taxas, he was from Montgomery County, he was a great Orphans Court judge. And we were at a convention. And he came up to me and he said, oh, he said, at last I meet the great Judge Ross. Unfortunately for me, Judge Everall was standing next to me. So after that, he made it his mission to try to get me out of the Orphans Court. And I had a book coming out then called Will Contest. And my lawyer, who's here, encouraged me to fight him. And the case was sent to the federal court in New Jersey. Can you believe it? Because they felt no court in Pennsylvania could hear it. Well, as it turned out, we settled the case finally, and he agreed I was to go back to the Orphans Court. But my term ended. So that was the end of the Orphans Court for me then. After my term ended, I became the fraudulent contractor case. I had cases involving fraudulence in making a contract. So I called myself the fraudulent contractor.
Not the contractor.
You know about that?
No, I'm saying, you called yourself a fraudulent contract with judge.
Okay. He should come along with Doris Smith Bender and told me about the Commonwealth Court and how wonderful it was. And I had a dear friend who was on there, Judge Silvestri. His name was Silvestri Silvestri. The judge would repeat. And he went to Judge Collins, and Judge Collins was delighted to have me appointed to the Commonwealth Court. And I happily served there for 8 years until the money ran out and all of us senior judges had to quit. So after that, my daughter became ill and I had to take care of her. And unfortunately, she passed away. And now, what do I do? Lots of things. Read a lot of books, get in touch with people who come to see me, have a lot of friends.
Father is,
I don't want to call him my caretaker, but that's what he is. And he's been very kind to me. And I'd love to entertain questions if there are any.
Any questions?
I'll tell you a few funny stories about when I was in court, things that happened. One man got on the stand, a witness, and his attorney asked him, will you tell us your name? And he started snapping his fingers and whistling. And he turned to me and he said, doggone it, Judge, I knew it this morning. We used to commit people for treatment for mental illness. And I committed a man who was in the manic state, which is up on top. He was bipolar. And before they let him away for treatment, he said, I want to make a speech. And I said, go ahead. And he said, well, he said, it's a pleasure to be committed by a member of the master sex. And then as they let him off for treatment, he went out in the hall, and Judge Schwartz's courtroom was being painted, and all of his furniture was out in the hall. So he turned around to the sheriff, and he said, listen, Fatso, when I come back here, I want this place cleaned up. Say to me, put on your bulletproof hat. So I was sitting there one day, and Charlie George, the sheriff who was supposed to guard me, said, don't worry, Judge, he said, if they shoot you, I'll shoot them. So there's lots of fun in court, too. You do have a lot of funny witnesses. But I do want to thank the members of the Women's Bar Section for this wonderful event. I'm so sorry that Ross Whitman passed away. I just can't believe it. She was so vital. And if there are any questions, I'll be glad to take them.
Judge yes. Ross, I came to bar in 1975, and you have always been an inspiration for all of us, so thank you very much.
That's not a question, that's a comment. Thank you so much. Anybody, any other questions?
Cheryl, well, I had to come here out of my retirement when I heard about the event, because Judge Ross, you are special. And I remember trying many termination of parental rights cases. conversations together in your chambers. So I thank you.
I thank you. I remember your coming to me and trying to decide what it was you wanted to do. And we talked it over and you decided.
Jim?
Jim Logan has to make a
say. I hope I don't get choked up here. I tend to blubber. My name is Jim Logan. I'm honored to have been allowed to speak here today. I wrote a little statement, and I thank the committee for permitting me to read this. It's called Judge Eunice Ross, a courageous voice for women, a role model for all lawyers and judges.
Thank you.
My most memorable interaction with the distinguished and learned, excuse me. I told my wife I was prone to do this. She's seen it before. And learned Judge Ross occurred not when I appeared before her, but when I, working with my co-counsel Louise Malakoff and Michael Malakoff, was preparing for a major gender discrimination case in federal district court in late 1978, 38 years ago. I asked her to testify on behalf of two women court reporters employed in the Family Division of the Court of Common Pleas who were being paid about $8,000 a year less than two male court reporters in the Orphans Court Division. All four were pen reporters, with a great shorthand. All were long-term employees. And the case was entitled Heard, H-E-R-D, versus Court of Common Pleas of Allegheny County. There were a number of individual defendants also. It was a clear case of pay disparity. Today, it would be a simple case. It was not then. The major factual defense was that the work of the court reporters in the Orphans Court was more difficult because the male reporters were recording testimony in cases that involved a large amount of money, whereas the female reporters were recording testimony not involving large amounts of money, but allegedly involving more, quote, minor, unquote, matters, such as child custody, support, alimony, and so forth. Could you imagine? Our argument in response was that recording the testimony in Orphans Court was rather simple and pro forma, such as recording yes answers to questions such as, are you the executor of the estate of so-and-so deceased? Did you cause this first and final account to be prepared? Is everything in the first and final account true and accurate? And so forth. The testimony in Family Division, on the other hand, typically involved a marital couple hollering at each other, speaking at the same time, with tensions running high, and the court trying to control the proceedings. The hearings in family court often went long into the evening with few breaks. Testimony from our clients, two women court reporters, and other court reporters that we called, was that it was much harder and took more skill to record testimony accurately in the family court, and in any event, the duties of the court reporters in family court required equal skill, effort, and responsibility. There was simply no basis, no factual basis, for the disparity in pay. The case had been pending at the EEOC and the district court for a good while, and after a protracted period of discovery, the case was finally set for trial. I was a fairly young attorney then, having been in practice only since 1970. I think I was 33 years old. I had never sued the Court of Common Pleas for any matter, much less regarding a matter so controversial and highly visible. Indeed, some of my peers, I think most of my peers, thought we were crazy pursuing the court when we would have to appear in front of many of these same judges in the future. The Supreme Court of Pennsylvania came in for the trial, and its attorney was opposing us, assisting the large law firm which was representing the Court of Common Pleas, the president, judge, and the court administrator. The atmosphere was very intimidating. Judge Ross encouraged me. Prayer.
Jim Tuck if I look at them.
Well, I love him, Jim.
Judge Ross encouraged me not to lose heart, to keep on fighting the case, even if I might give some pushback from other judges. The Court of Common Pleas was split over which side to take. We had seven judges willing to testify for our side. The other side had three, including Judge Savarola and Robert Doyle. Judge Ross was our first judicial witness. Obviously, we wanted to pick the best one who would make the most important presentation because the other judges, we feared their testimony would be regarded as cumulative. She was viewed by some of her judicial peers as having been disloyal for testifying. To walk down Grant Street to testify in federal district court. She was very forthright in her testimony and was most impressive, naturally. Although we lost a portion of the case, which was tried non-jury, in another portion of the case, we obtained a confidential settlement for our clients. This case helped to change the pay disparity that had existed for so long. Without Judge Ross's encouragement and courageous testimony, the gender disparity issues might well not have been resolved so quickly. I've always admired Judge Ross. Her entire career is a model for any attorney or judge to follow. She had brains and she used them. She exuded class, grace, and civility. She manifested a social conscience. I have been privileged to know her. I have considered her a dear friend all these many years. Happy birthday, Judge Ross, and many more.
So I think we'll have time for some other questions in just a little bit. Shelley, do you want to say just a few words about Judge Ross's charity as well?
When we were interviewing Judge Ross for this special event, and we spent many hours talking to the judge, we recognized that it, even though 5 years, the last 5 years of her term as a judge, before she aged out, now this was 12 years ago,